y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was going to say. Sisters got happy.
I love them old church.
Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and
singing.
All of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
I want to give good news to the church. Well, there's good and bad news in the text, but you know, with God, he always takes that which sometimes don't seem good, and it make it good. Am I right about it? Amen. That's the kind of God we serve. He can take some rough situations and make them into some very promising opportunities for us. This is found in Jeremiah chapter 29. In verse number 11, this pericope of scripture that Judge read gives the synopsis. This encapsulizes the very essence of God and his work during the time of Jeremiah's day. And what's compellingly interesting is that we are able to glean in on a conversation between the prophet and God, and God says something to him that is relevant or apropos to us tonight. God says something to him that oftentimes when we are blue texting or pearl stringing, we want to hear. We want to hear good stuff from God. Amen.
Amen.
When times are hard, times are rough, we want a word from God.
Amen.
And so it's good when you read. Not just anybody, but the Bible says, and God says, for I know my thoughts of you.
Yes.
God says, I know what I'm doing in your life tonight.
Yes.
I don't care what you're going through, what you're dealing with. I'm in control. That's enough to say thank you, Jesus, right there.
Man.
What is the background? Well, when we... You know, in the old days when a preacher preached, he'd have to treat the text before he started preaching. And so I still treat the text first. So you don't just read a scripture and I just say anything. And you just walk out like they do with denominationalism. You just walk out and just say, oh, didn't he preach? But I didn't preach the text.
Man.
And so I want to preach the text so that you can understand why God says to Jeremiah, for I know my thoughts concerning you.
Uh-huh.
I know what I'm doing. And you know, God knows everything. He is speaking to Jeremiah because Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, has been proclamating and proclaiming to the children of Israel that they were going into bondage.
Yeah.
That they were going into captivity with Nebuchadnezzar.
Yes.
An awful Babylonian king.
Uh-huh.
A tyrant, a beast, a vicious person. You know him. He's the one who had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego put into the fiery furnace. He had Daniel put into the lion's den. But before all that happened, Jeremiah received word from God that tell them that they're going into captivity and under the rule purposely by me into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar. Now that's good news, and the good news is I know what I'm doing. Look at his name and say, he know what he's doing.
Know what he's doing.
You know what he's doing. Now, you got to trust and believe that now. He said, I know what I'm doing. But not only, here's the rough part of Jeremiah. Not only is he saying to Jeremiah that they're going into captivity, but you're going into captivity also.
Mm.
Amen. He gives, in essence, the reason why they're going into captivity. Somebody wasn't praying like they ought to be praying.
Well,
somebody wasn't turning to God like they needed to turn to God. Somebody wasn't giving him glory like they should have given him glory. They had turned themselves to idols and had begun to live more like the world than they did children of God. And God says that I know my thoughts concerning you, thoughts of good and not evil, to give you an expected end. In other words, it's going to get bad, but you can expect in the end you're going to be on top.
Yes.
I know you don't want to go. I know you don't want to go through it, but I got a plan. The name of this lesson, God has a plan.
Yes.
And whatever you're going through today, this very night, I want you to know that God has a plan. He knows what he's doing. Man. And he allows the children of Israel by design to go into bondage under the hands of Nebuchadnezzar. Why are you doing it, God? He said, because then when times get hard, y'all ought to say amen. When times get rough, you will call on me. Is that in your Bible?
Man.
That's just a way different. Y'all was like that in your Bible. Jeremiah 29, verse 3 said, then will you call upon me? You hadn't called on me.
Yeah.
You hadn't called on me. You act like you forgot about me. You hadn't said thank you, Jesus, in so long. You hadn't said thank you, Lord, in so long. You hadn't said, help me, Lord, in so long. He said, but if I allow you to turn you over to yourself and these deals that you broke with these kings who are not my people, now you disrespect and dishonor me, I'm going to step back. I'm going to leave you in the hands of this tyrant, because once he gets through with you, you might not have been praying then, but you sure enough going to pray now.
Man.
You might have been listening, worshiping like you need to, but you sure enough going to worship now. And isn't that just like us today, church? We sometimes act like it's just routine to come into the house of God, and almost like there was no price paid to come into the house of God. And
uh-huh.
We act like we're doing God a favor,
yeah,
and the preacher a favor, and God looks and says, yeah, you know what? I know my thoughts of you. Thoughts are good and not evil from a theological standpoint, an ethological standpoint. Whenever a person sees God as evil and see him as mean, they become mean and hateful towards somebody else. If they believe God will beat them up, they'll start beating up somebody else. But when you see God as graceful and merciful and kind, you treat other folk graceful, merciful, and kind, because that's your eschatological view of Christ, of God and Christ. And when you know God, like Jeremiah knew God, you can go into the enemy's camp and know that everything is going to be all right.
Man.
He said, I know what I'm doing. Don't panic. I know you're going through some stuff tonight that's rough, unthinkable, incomprehensible, unbelievable at times, but if you just stick to the plan, if you just stick to the plan, God says, I'm going to teach you how to pray through the stuff that you go through.
Man.
I'm going to teach you how to pray through the persecution that you go through. I'm going to teach you how to pray through the pain that you go through. I'm going to teach you how to pray through the problems that you go through. You will call on me. You've been calling on me. I wouldn't listen to you. Why wouldn't I listen to you? Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 through 2. He says, not that my ear is heavy that I can't hear. It's not that I can't, my arm is short that I can't save you. He said, but you've been living in sin.
Right.
And you've been dancing and fighting with the devil. I saw you 2 seconds with the devil. He says, so I will not listen to you. I won't answer you. But what I'm going to do, when you call on me now, when you turn to me, I listen to you, I hearken to you, and we can be back together again.
Man.
Sometime, church.
Yeah.
Sometime you got to go through hell to appreciate heaven.
Man.
Amen. Sometimes you got to go through this stuff right now that you're going through to appreciate when the church was full. Sometimes you got to lose some preachers before you learn how to appreciate
some preachers.
Having to come out, say,
man.
Sometimes you got to leave you for a couple of nights. Amen. So you learn about roses on Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
You learn to smile and compliment some. Sometimes folk got to just set you down somewhere and let you alone till you come to your senses and realize that everybody needs God. Everybody needs
man.
God.
Man.
Yeah. I'm just so mindful that every text that we preach from the Old Testament is pointing to the New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
You remember it was in Romans chapter 15. For the things that are written aforetime were written for our learning.
Yes.
That we might have hope and comfort and patience through the power of the scriptures.
Man.
Now, I listen to sermons these days, and folks are preaching everything but the church. Yeah, I told my deacons today, I said, you know why churches are not full? Because we quit preaching the church in the text. Folks are got up now trying to be smart. Let me tell you something. You can't beat T.D. Jakes being T.D. Jakes.
Man.
You can't beat Creflo Tell a Lie. Being crap don't tell a lie.
Man.
But let me tell you something. They can't beat the gospel.
Amen.
It is preached to the people of God.
Man.
And as a matter of fact, the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse number 75, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, Jesus Christ. For it is the power unto salvation. And so every time we see a text, we ought to be able to let the church know what the text is about and how does it relate to the church. There's nothing that God wrote that don't relate to his church.
Man.
Well, surely then, preach while you're running your mouth. Amen. I'm glad you asked that question. Add 10 more minutes, but it's worth
about this, the children of Israel doing what? Going into bondage. They're going under who? Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel begins to write, in the days of Jesus' kingdom shall the Lord of heaven set up a new kingdom that shall never be destroyed. The Babylonian kingdom is in place in that vision. And so when God says there is expected in, he said there's expected in because Daniel will prophesy it. Daniel will say that his church will be seen coming down as a stone will crush and devour the Assyrians, the Greeks, and everybody else around, even the Romans, but it shall last forever. And get this, it will never be left to other people.
Man.
That's the church in the text.
Man.
He said, I'm sending you into the situation, but the church is going to be all right. That was the name said, church is going to be all right.
Church is going to be all right.
Church is going to be all right. God knows what he's doing in God's plan. We find that God is a planning God. Amen. Anyhow, he's a planning God from the very beginning. God planned, and in his planning, he knows what he's doing. Now, here's the bad news of the text. Okay, I'm Jeremiah, and God will explain all this stuff, that what I'm doing is related to the church. I'm not doing it just to punish nobody. I ain't just messing with folk. I'm trying to bring us back together because I have a plan that I'm working on that's bigger than you. Well, God, what are you doing? What do you mean you got a plan bigger than me? Well, here's the problem. Here's the problem, Jeremiah. My plan, I want y'all to get this now, is a 75-year plan.
Well...
Amen. The Jews were in captivity, not for a weekend, not for 3 months.
Yeah.
See, this is we find when you're Christian. I'm gonna find my Christian folk now. I'm gonna find who holding on to God's unchanging hand. Y'all saying hold on to God's unchanging hand, but you need to add that for 70 years. Mm. Hold on to his unchanging hand.
Yeah.
He said, they would go under Babylonian rule through 4 kings. Through dispensation of time, through decades, they would be under Babylonian rule from one king to another, the Assyrian, the Persian, they would be under rule, but in the end, you'll win. So what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that I don't care what goes, I don't care what happened, don't leave the plan.
Man.
Because you serve a planning God.
Yes.
And if God got a plan that's 70 years, in the end, you still
part of the
win.
Plan. Yes, sir.
Y'all looking at me funny. I told you God is a planning God. Y'all all right?
Yeah.
Y'all, but he's a planning God. I said, I know my thoughts. I know my plans I have for you. Look at the next thing. He got a plan for me.
He got a plan for me.
And the order of the hand along the plan, y'all say amen. If you got a soft that big old head up, and you won't go for it too long, but if you got a hard head, he got a plan for you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I know my plan. I know what I'm doing. Isaiah 55, verse 8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. I don't think like you think. My ways are not your ways. For as the heavens is higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than yours. I know what I'm doing. I know what it's going to take. I got some generations to die out because you've lived so vile in your life. You've not given me glory most of your life. You've fake worship all your life. I got to let the third and the fourth generation pass down by. And I got to bring up a new group of people that'll give me glory, that'll shout in the morning, that'll say thank you, Jesus, when I do something for you.
Yeah.
And understand that I've got Almighty God all by myself. If you understand that plan, talk to Joseph. Job said that God is a planning God. We read in Genesis chapter 37 or so, where Joseph says, I have a dream, and then my staff stood up, and yours prayed absolutely to me. His brothers got upset with him. And we read very swiftly through the chapters of time how that they threw him down into a pit to leave him for dead. How he cried, Brother, why are you doing it like that? Have you ever wondered why are folk treating you like they treating you? Why do they hate you so bad?
Well,
and does it bother you sometimes that maybe it's all in the plan? Amen. Maybe it's all in the plan. And perhaps the problem is not what they're doing, but the problem is what God is doing in your life.
Man.
Because God's plan is bigger than your problem.
Yes.
God's plan supersedes your thought process.
Man.
For his thoughts are not your thoughts, nor his ways your ways. So when you're going through something, to speak against the plan is to speak against God.
Man.
Joseph goes down into that pit. They pull him up out the pit. And then they sell him to some slave owners. Take him down to Potiphar's house.
plan.
Part of the plan. Joseph now is over everything now. And all of a sudden the wife said Joseph tried to get with her. And Joseph broke out running. Because he knew it when somebody says something, and you in your position, he must have been black, he knew he had better start running. When accused of something like that, y'all say amen. And so he takes off running. And then he finds himself in Egypt. But how long was it from the pit to the palace? How long was it that God's plan evolved from the pit to the palace? And do you have faith to maintain and to stay strong in the plan from the pit that you're in now to the palace that God has ready for you?
Yes.
But there was 13 years that passed, over a decade that passed, while he waited and trusted and believed in God. Well, where is the church in there? There are over 106 descriptions of Joseph that points to him as a type of Christ, but Christ is the any type. In other words, he's known as a type of Christ, but he's pointed to the coming of Christ.
Man.
Joseph didn't do nothing wrong, but his self, am I right about it?
Yes,
he was lying on it. Jesus was lying on it. For who shall believe our report? He should run before him as a tender root, a root out of dry ground.
Yes.
We should see if there's no form or covenant that we should desire him. He was persecuted. He was beaten. And by his stripes, we are healed. Joseph went through hell to help folk enjoy heaven on the other side.
Man.
For 13 years, he trusted in the Lord. And some of us need to go on through something right now. And so if I can't take too much more than this. Well, if you had to suffer 75 years, you ain't suffered 13 years, you have some standards that's been set.
Well,
you had to suffer long enough. Some of y'all go through some 10 minutes. Somebody, Lord, what you gonna do? It's been a long time. It hadn't been 13 years. It hadn't been 75. Y'all want to say amen?
Man.
You haven't seen suffer. But these men stuck to the plan. And in the end, it is Joseph that's standing in the palace. His brothers that betrayed him. People that didn't help him. Who looked at them and said, that's all right. Because I now see the plan that God had in my life. Brother, you meant it for evil. But God made it for good.
Man,
why? Because it was bigger than us. Why? To save alive my people.
Man.
And sometimes, if you got to go through some stuff so your neighbor can see Jesus in you, then it's worth going through.
Well,
God, I say amen.
Man.
Sometimes the church have to humble itself enough and stomach some stuff and go through some stuff so a visitor will see Jesus. It's worth the plan.
Yes.
Sometimes if the wife got to go through some stuff and put up with some stuff in order for folk to see Jesus, it's worth the plan.
Man.
Oh, God has a plan for each and every one of us. He has a plan designed specifically for you and for me and Jeremiah. Lastly, when we look at God's plan, we realize that when we begin to count time, that when God said in Ephesians chapter 2, that before the foundation of the world, God had already purposed his mind that he would save man. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
He knew that old Eve would bite of that forbidden tree. He knew that her husband would tattoo over there and just start eating with him. Am I right about it? He knew that man would fall in the garden. And guess what? It is a surprise to God because God
knew.
Had a plan. Am I right about it? How do you know? Because what happens the next 2100 years was all a part of the plan. Every king that died and succeeded was a part of the plan. David's bloodline through Jesse was part of the plan. The house of Judah was part of the plan. The house of Benjamin was a part of the plan. Everybody that died, every prophet that died and was stoned was part of the plan. But what are you talking about? Whenever you start talking about starting a church, you need to not disallow, dishonor the plan. You can't start a church without the plan including the blood of folk who paid and died for the church to be here. In particular, Jesus Christ, death was planned from the beginning of the time.
Man.
And the start of a church, without it being inclusive in the plan, what should be inclusive in the plan? Well, Isaiah chapter 2, about the fourth verse. Y'all remember this celebration day, that in the last day shall God have set up his kingdom. And he said, let's be set on top of the mountain, all people shall flow under him, and they shall go, and it shall begin where? In Jerusalem. Micah's twin scripture says that the church will begin where? In Jerusalem. That's not just in scripture to just think about to him. It's in scripture because it's a part of a 2100 year plan by God. No, the Catholic cannot be the church because it's a 600 year plan. This was a 2100 year plan. No, Joseph Smith can't be the right church. It's not old enough. It's not prophesizing old, not fulfilled in the new. It can't be a part of the plan.
Amen.
And if you're sitting here and you're not a member of the Lord's church, you are outside of the plan of salvation that requires you to be in the church that God planned to bring salvation unto mankind.
Amen.
Acts chapter 4, verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other name whereby man can be saved.
Amen.
In heaven. And everything all right about it. Y'all all right?
Yes.
So far you learned what's it like? That God has a what?
Has a plan.
God has a plan. If you're going through something right now, don't speak of this. I want you to smile. If you're going to smile, look at somebody and say, God got a plan for you.
Got a plan.
Y'all got to say it like it means. You're going to say it. If you want to 75, 13 year, or 2100 year, you got to say, God got a plan for us.
Got a plan.
I want this church to know, I don't care where you are right now, what you're going through. Don't think what you're going through today. Just remember, he said, the text says, I have an expected end for you. God expects you to hang in there and win.
Man.
God expects you to remain faithful in the midst of the fire.
Man.
God expects you to be able to know you can count on him, that he'll never leave you nor forsake you.
Man.
God wants you to know that no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper.
Yes,
God wants us to know in 2 Corinthians 10 and verse number 4, for the weapons of this warfare are mighty to the tearing down of strongholds. I don't care what you're dealing with. God says, I got a plan. I tear it down. If somebody try to put you in bondage, I tear it down. When your enemy, look at the text, when your enemy rise up, I tear them down.
Man.
It's all part of the plan.
Man.
The problem is that sometimes the people try to be bigger than the plan. The plan is bigger than the person. Amen. Jeremiah was a big old crybaby. Jeremiah busts out crying. I'm gonna send you in. Ooh, it's too much. No. God says to Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse number 5, he said, listen, when he was in your mother's womb, y'all like, say amen.
Yeah.
When he was in your mother's womb,
uh-huh,
I formed thee.
Yes.
And while you was in your mother's womb, I was getting you ready.
Mm-hmm.
I sanctified you.
Yes,
I set you apart for this work. I don't know what you're talking about, but what I'm about to do, Jeremiah, is bigger than you.
Man.
What are you saying? I'm saying to you that are sitting here right now, I don't care what you're going through, you already been conditioned, you already been prepared, you already have been so tough enough to go through whatever you're going through, or you would not be going through it in the first place.
Man.
But because with the temptation, God always makes a way to escape. You going through it because you were the best candidate to go through it.
Man.
You gotta be proud. You going,
yes,
to, you going to raise your hand. You going, you broke right now, raise your hand. You know how to be broke. And God knows you know how to be broke. Everybody know how to be broke. That little robbing banks is going on. Am I right about it? If you're hurting right now, raise your hand. You go there because God said the person knows how to handle it. The best people I know, they know how to handle it.
Man.
And so I'm not letting you go through something that I don't expect you to win. And I wouldn't let her go through it because she can't handle it. I can't let him go through it, but I chose you as Job. Am I right about it? Job minded his own business. He was in there praying. Am I right about it?
Man.
He minded his own business. And then the devil come up talking. He walked up with the sons of God, and they're sitting there talking on what the devil doing with the sons of God. But the devil showed his own nasty, ugly self up, probably brushing teeth or combing his hair. Then he came up talking about, you know, what about Job? What about Job? He only worshiped you because you good to him. He only talked of you good to him. What about him? He said, well, what about Job? Yeah, he's a good man. Right, I tell you, he's in your head. Why are you doing that, God? Because he's the best candidate. He's the best candidate for the job.
Man.
What children? What his wife? When you're going through something, you're going through something because you're the number one candidate to go through it. And God said, I want you to expect that I'm going to go through it with you. Not only are you going to go through it, we're going to conquer it, we're going to win, we're going to do something because it's not about them. It's to show you to love God all by myself.
Man.
And some of us, we haven't had the experience with God to where we can just look and say, man, God did that. Oh, it strengthened my my faith. When I go through some real stuff, and I look back through all my tears and all my pain, and I know it wasn't nobody but Jesus.
Yeah.
It does my heart good when I lay down, and I know I'm not supposed to be sleeping, but God gives me sweet rest in the middle of the storm. Y'all about to say amen. Oh, it does my heart good when I don't see a way. God makes a way out of no way. And all I can say is thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Oh, he said, Jeremiah, this plan is bigger than you. Not only did Jeremiah, some of us would have looked at Paul. God had a plan for Paul. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 12, you remember it was Paul, his name was Saul then. But Paul said, but when it pleased the Lord, he separated me from my mother's womb. And now he separated me, but he separated me. Why did you separate me unto himself? Why did you separate me? Because Christ was in you. Have y'all seen that? Have y'all seen that verse?
Man.
I need a little bit of Galatians chapter. This will blow your mind. This will blow your mind. I'm studying it, and I'm reading, and I see this, and I go, whoa. When Saul was dragging folk out of the church, Christ was in it.
Y'all
got why, didn't
you? Yeah.
That's why y'all got to, you know why y'all leave folk alone? Because you don't know the what?
The plan.
You don't know the plan. I don't know what God do. Y'all leave you out. You don't know the plan. Look at Galatians chapter 2, I believe verse 12. What's the Bible say? When it says, but when it pleased the Lord, you have a preacher, deacon, y'all have it. But when it pleased the Lord, you say amen, we have it. I drank you some water right here. Amen. Amen. I think y'all been a wonderful church. I'm going to get you out of here too. I'm almost through this. That way y'all have me back one day. If I sit up here until midnight, I know I ain't coming back. Amen. And then when I call, I say, why y'all have me back? No part of the plan. Okay. All right. All right. Who got it? That ain't on me now. It's on them. 2:12, I believe it is.
Mm-hmm.
When it pleased the Lord, is it 1:12? When it pleased the Lord,
I'm looking at 2:12.
Yeah.
For now, for I need
Galatians 1:15.
1:15. All right, let's look.
When
it pleased God,
who separated me from my mother's womb, All
right.
Called me by my grace.
Hold on a minute. He called me by what?
By his grace.
By his grace.
By his grace.
All right, read.
To reveal his son in me.
Hold on, to do what?